62.
Oh, that's right.
Again, Johnny,
we played
against
each other. That's right. That's right. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I played in three.
Just
we
go
played
on over here.
One
just go on this.
61 when you were at Richmond.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
You were at Richmond. I was at Charleston.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What a league that
was. You and
was.
The Miners yeah. together?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that one year.
Yeah.
That one year.
Wow. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is Donnie G. Let's Talk Sports, and you've already met our guest, but let me tell you this. This is going to be a great show. Scotty will be joining us shortly. 1964, Cardinals played the Yankees. I was defending this great country. I was in Germany at the time, and during my three-year tenure, not one Nazi ever stepped foot in Idaho. So we defended the shores of this country. But I listened to this game on radio. Game 5 of this particular series, which was ultimately won by the Cardinals, was at Yankee Stadium, and I'm probably wrong on some of this, but this is as close as I can. I'm recollecting as it was a pretty good matchup. Bob Gibson was going for the Cardinals, and Mel Stottlemyre was going for the Yankees. Going into the ninth, with two out in the bottom of the ninth, the Yankees were down by one run, followed by the name of Tom Tresh.
Two runs.
Was it a two-run homer?
Yeah.
It was
2-0.
Bottom of the ninth with two outs, the Yankees were down by two runs, and Mr. Tom Tresh got up and hit a home run and tied the game. Goes into extra innings, and it was at the bottom of the 10th?
Top of the 10th.
Was it a one or a two-run home
three.
Run?
Three-run homers.
Mm-hmm. I'm always close, but I'm never right. And won the game. So we've got...
You're doing
Tim
McCarver.
Tim McCarver was the one who won the game with a three-run homer in the top of the 10th, and I'm just so proud and delighted to have Tom Tresh and Tim McCarver here tonight. And we're going to get to them real quick. I just want to just go over... couple things. I want again to thank all our sponsors. We're just so fortunate to have great sponsors. As far as callers, we've already got the lines are full. We'll try to work the lines. But we also wanted to stick with baseball tonight. I'll do Lark's Trivia. If we can get to it, fine. If we can't, don't worry about it. So I'm going to give you Lark's Trivia right away. And are we ready on this one, Mike, for the trivia? Okay, well, hopefully it'll be on the board. First one, these are kind of tough. Who holds the record for the most home runs in the World Series? Number two, they might show up on the board. I'm going to go right through them, and then we'll show them up later. Name the left-handed pitcher who has the most victories in the National League. He's a National League pitcher who has the most victories for a left-hander. Came from my hometown. Who was the number three is, who was the American League's Rookie of the Year in 1962? Number four, what team holds the record for the most home runs in a single season? Number five, name the only National League pitcher to win four Cy Young Awards. And the last one is, name the manager who led his team to a record 5 consecutive World Series victories. So those are your Lark's Trivia. Let me just say, Tom Tresh played with the Yankees from 1961 through 1969, ended up with his last season with Detroit. Signed as an amateur free agent. I'm not familiar with how that worked. But he was a Rookie of the Year. He was 1965. He was an American League Golden Glove outfielder, and he made the All-Star game in 62 and 63 as a shortstop. Tim McCarver, I'm sure you're all aware who Tim McCarver is. He's probably known more today as a broadcast journalist, an award-winning broadcast journalist. But this gentleman played 21 years in Major League Baseball. He was a rookie at the age of 17. I still had a paper route at that age. Won two World Series, lost when he won in 64 and 67. In 64, you batted 478, and in 68, when you lost against Detroit, am I correct?
Mm-hmm.
You batted 333. And the list could go on and on and on. Thanks for coming, guys. That's all I can tell you. It's just
pleasure.
Just a real honor. And
pleasure. You should have mixed that average in what I hit against Boston, 125. That was the sandwich in between there. So it's kind of the good and the bad.
But you won
right?
the series, though. You won the series.
We won the series, yeah. Right.
I don't care about those, Tim. All I know is you really ripped the ball against us.
Yeah. What a great series that was.
That was a good
series. And this is the first time I've seen Tom since that World Series.
Yeah. No way. You're talking about since 1964?
First time I've seen Tom tonight since the World Series in 64. That's right.
Wow. That's amazing. I didn't know that. Wow, that's terrific. I mean, you guys
only
are kind
40
of
years
in
ago.
History.
Well, I think, back when they were playing those old-timer games, You were still broadcasting at that time, so you weren't playing in many of those,
no,
I don't think. And I was playing in four or five of them a year, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And but we, you know, and I ran into a lot of players during that time, but didn't have a chance to run into you.
When Tom hit the home run in game five of the 64 World Series, the teams were tied, two games apiece. We split in St. Louis. We won the first game. The Yankees won the second game. Mantle hits a home run in the ninth inning of game three off Barney Schultz. He hit it forever.
Third deck.
480 feet, third deck. It was hanging knuckleball. You wish, from a catcher standpoint, you want to go out and interfere with the ball like that. But so with the Yankees up 2-1, Kenny Boyer hit a grand slam home run in the sixth inning after the Yankees scored three in the first of game four, and we won 4-3. Ron Taylor and Roger Craig had great relief appearances in that game.
You know, we had a play there. I know you'll remember it, but
in
the sixth inning, Richardson, the ball got hung up in his glove. And
right.
He hung kind of, Lins was coming across the bag, and the throw was kind of behind him, and
right.
We missed the play, and we won out at the time. So if you turn a double play, we're out of the inning. And Kenny doesn't come up to lead the next inning off.
I think Dick Groat hit the
Groat hit the ball.
So instead of a double play to get out of it, that loads the bases, and Kenny
and he hits it out.
Al Downing, I think it was an 0-2 changeup, just off whatever the plate away, and Boyer reaches out and hooks it around the pole in left field. And then the next day, there were no night games in those days. Night baseball in the World Series. I think
there was no night games.
All day games. All day games.
It had to be one of the last times it was day games only.
We played in six World Series together. Tom played in three, I played in three, and we never played a night World Series game. But anyway, in game five, in that ninth inning, Bob Gibson had a 2-0 shutout. And the hitter, two hitters before Tom was Pepitone, I believe, right?
No, right before me.
Oh, it was right
before. Mantle got on.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
And then Pepitone hits the ball right off his...
I think he walked.
And Pepitone hit a ball off of... Huh?
Mantle walked, and then Pepitone
came up.
Right.
Now, how many outs are there?
Two outs.
Bottom of the ninth.
Right.
And we're down 2-0. Yankees are down 2-0.
Right.
And Pepitone hits a ball hard right off of Gibson's hip, and he made it. Greatest play that I've
It was
ever
a basketball
seen.
Play.
You were talking
I
about
mean,
that today.
What a play. What agility he had to get off that mound, because Pepitone runs good.
Yeah.
And got off and made that play. It was close, but he had him. And so consequently, he wasn't on first base, and I hit the next, you know,
next pitch.
I think it was the next pitch, and hit it out and tied the score. While Pepe had been on, it had been 3-2. We didn't want it.
But was Gibson feeling any pain from the drive that the ball had hit him?
It was like a one hopper. No,
it wasn't. You know, so it wasn't a line drive.
He would never show it anyway.
No, that's right. You don't feel. You feel that in November.
No.
How do you?
But when the ball hit him, the ball squirted toward the third base line, and Bob went up. And the reason I say it was a basketball move is he picked the ball up and barehanded and turned and threw while he was in the air.
He went three or four steps to his right, though.
Yeah,
it wasn't just laying there.
Yeah,
he went over there and had to throw
back against his body. And it was an extraordinary play and a big play for the reasons that Tom just explained.
So now let's get this. Now, Tom is coming up with two out in the ninth. He's got two men on?
One on.
Okay.
Because Pepitone was out.
Okay, Pepitone was out. Okay.
But
so
Mantle smoked it, too. I mean, he hit it to the biggest part of the ballpark.
Was it the first pitch?
I think it was the first pitch fastball. Down and in. I remember the location of the pitch. And so that tied at Yankee Stadium. And in those days, Yankee Stadium held 67,000 people. So
I think
the stadium went crazy, not naturally. So it's tied 2 games apiece going in, and we're tied 2-2 going to the top of the ninth inning. So can't get much better than that.
The first time anybody hit a home run with two outs in the last of the ninth inning in the World Series.
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that until a couple of guys did it in with the Yankees.
Mazeroski's was not
baseman,
with
for who?
Who were they?
Since that time, you mean?
Yeah, the third baseman.
What team?
With the Yankees, just before...
Nettles?
Nettles?
No, after him. just recently retired, and I can't think of his name, but his last name starts with a B.
Ventura?
Who?
Pally Ruler?
Wade Boggs?
No.
Boggs?
No, Brocious. Like,
yeah.
Brocious.
Oh, Brocious.
Brocious hit
yeah.
one. Scott hit
yeah,
one.
Right, right.
And then somebody else hit one after that. But anyway, on TV, they had mentioned that that's the first time since I'd hit mine. Well, mine was so shortly lived.
Yeah.
I mean, I was a hero for maybe about 5 minutes.
Tino Martinez did one the night before.
Yeah, okay.
The night
that's
before,
what it was.
Two out and two. It happened back to back in the 2001 World Series, where two out home runs tied the game for the Yankees. Martinez hit it off Young Hung Kim in game four. To tie it, the Yankees won it, and then Brocious hit it in game five.
Now, you're getting up there with two out in the ninth, and Gibson is pitching a shutout.
Right.
And you don't, I mean, I can't think of anybody worse to go up against when you've only got one out left. What are your thoughts as you're walking up there?
Well,
you're looking for a fastball?
I was, because that's his best pitch. And he challenges you with the ball, too. You know, but that's no assurance. I've been up there a lot of other times against him and didn't hit it out. You know, so... You know, I mean, he's going after me with his best pitch. He made a pretty good pitch, and, you know, I just happened to hit it. That's all. I mean, those things happen. But nobody likes to get up with two outs in the last of the ninth inning. You're down, you know.
The world is watching
it's
you.
It's there, you know.
Did Gibson say anything when he went into the dugout after he tied the game? Because, I mean, you came so close.
No.
Well, it didn't last long because you know, I mean, he got up, a couple guys got on, and boom, you hit it, and that was it. So my glory lasted maybe about 10 minutes.
Okay, let's talk about you now. You came up with who started off the top of the tenth?
We had an unusual play happen in the top of the tenth because Dick Groat tried to bunt Bill White to third base, and Elston Howard was catching. He bunted through the ball, and Howard threw behind. White at second base, and White went to third, and then Groat walked. So there's one out and runners on at first and third, and Pete Mickelson was the pitcher. Mm-hmm. And I hit a 3-1 pitch foul hard down the right field line and about 4 feet foul, and I was mad because I was thinking, you know, I'm not going to see another pitch like that to hit.
Yeah.
And I did and hit it.
How does that feel?
Mantle was playing right field, and to see number 7 go back, you know, I knew that the ball was hit far enough to drive in the run. And in those days, Yankee Stadium was only like 354 to right center field, where the bullpen was, I believe, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it was only about 4 or 5 rows back, but it was enough.
Two of the really storied teams in baseball, the 64 Cardinals and the 61, 62, 63 Yankees. Let me ask you this, Tom. You were signed as an amateur free agent?
Well, there were no draft then.
There wasn't any draft then?
You know, so...
So what were you playing? Were you playing in high school or college? Or?
I was in my first year of college at the time. But today the rule is that you have to play 3 years of college before you're eligible to be drafted. At the time that I signed, there wasn't a rule like that. You could go play college and sign. I didn't sign out of high school primarily because I promised my family that I would go to college and get at least 3 years of college in. And
your dad played baseball, didn't he? Ray?
Yeah. Mike Tresh. He was a catcher with the White Sox. Number 15, just like you like me.
Is
yeah.
That right?
And so anyway, what happened is there was... when I was graduating from high school, which was in 1957, there was a rule that a major league team could not sign a ball player for more than, I think, about a $3,000 or $4,000 bonus, right. Or they would have to go directly. The player would have to go directly to the major league roster.
Really,
it happened to Joey Malfitano with the Giants.
Well, Cleet Boyer signed.
Cleet Boyer,
was another
right.
one.
What about you?
Al Kaline was another one.
When I signed in 59, that wasn't the case. They had, I think,
they
abandoned
changed
that
it because
rule after
58 they changed. Actually,
right.
They've changed
right.
it in 58. But
yeah.
So I had 1 year of college in, and they called me back and said, "We can give you more money now than $3,000. Are you interested in looking at it?" And I said, "Yeah." And so we made an appointment. Yankees came over. We told them what we wanted. They said that'd be good, and I signed, and off I went with the promise that I'd finish my degree in the off season, which I spent 12 years getting my college degree.
go to
In
West,
fact, I was
Western
the only
Michigan?
Central Michigan.
Central Michigan.
I was the only student with tenure.
Older than the instructors.
Yeah, that's it. And then I ended up working at the university for 27 years before I retired 6 years ago. Yeah.
Oh, that's terrific.
I would think, though, if you were thinking about playing in the major leagues, especially with your father, Mike, having been experienced, so you were familiar with what goes on, you would have picked a different team than the 61 Yankees to try to break into that lineup. I mean, think of that
well,
lineup.
Well, you know, when I signed, my dad played 12 years in the major leagues and never was in a World Series. And my dad always respected the Yankees because they were there. And he said, and I had, Mickey Mantle became my idol because I was a switch hitter and, you know, he was the premier switch hitter. And so he was kind of my idol. So I, when my dad got out of, he did some managing in the minor leagues. And then when he got completely out of baseball, my affiliation to whatever teams that he was with at that time no longer stood. So I kind of became a Yankee fan. So the Yankees were really where I wanted to sign.
But did you look and say, okay, now I could go to the Philadelphia Athletics or whoever you want to name, the St. Louis Browns or somebody else?
Browns weren't in existence then, but the Cardinals
Let me
weren't.
Tell you, the scout that even signed me, a guy by the name of Pat Patterson, said, now remember, Tony Kubek was just Rookie of the Year as a shortstop. And I was a shortstop. I wasn't being cocky or anything. I just felt, you know, there are more than one position on this ball field, you know, because I play shortstop here doesn't mean that's my position. And that's kind of how it all kind of washed out, that I ended up in the outfield also, you know.
Well, left field was always a place where they would always put Yogi there. They would put, like yourself. Were you in the outfield when you were playing left, Mantle was center, and Maris was right?
Yes.
I mean, did you realize...
Not in the series, though. In the series, Mantle played right a lot.
Okay. Maris played center.
Roger played left.
I didn't know that. Did you realize that the history that this one, was going to go...
The one before team? We played. The other two before, right, though, we right. played it the other way.
Right. Mickey. So Mickey was in
Mickey
center.
Mickey was in center. And I was in
so how long were you in the minors?
About just shy of 4 years. So I signed when I was 18, turning 18, and I was 22 when I got to the major leagues.
So you came in, what, 61?
The last month of 61 season, yeah. So I got a chance to see Roger hit the 61 home runs. That was a thrill.
23,000 people in the stands the day Roger Maris hit his 61st home run.
Today, they were looking at Mark McGwire. It's a whole different... Right. They said he had real problems with the notoriety of chasing Ruth's record, and he really probably got a lot of bad press because the Bambino was so beloved. They certainly didn't.
That's basically what I
saw. They didn't want Roger Maris to beat the record.
That's what I saw. I thought that it would have been more acceptable for Mickey or Willie to break the record, but they didn't feel that Roger had been around long enough yet to deserve that. You know how they make those decisions, I guess, the fans and the press.
What was the relationship between Mantle and Maris?
Great. They had a great relationship. You know, I mean, I think the press would have liked to have it been different, but it wasn't. And I was there that whole last month of that, you know, when they were pursuing the record, and there was never any kind of an indication of jealousy or animosity or anything else going on. I mean, they both, we were in a fight to win the pennant at that time. When I got to New York, was called up from Richmond last in September the 1st, and the Yankees had a one-game lead over Detroit at the time, and I think it was like 2 weeks. We had a two-week homestand, and I never saw the Yankees lose. Mm-hmm. They just took off from there.
Because it was probably my cheerleading
that did it.
Have you been to Yankee Stadium before?
Prior to that, no.
You'd never been to Yankee Stadium?
No.
I can still remember the first time I went to Yankee Stadium. I was a young kid, and I got lost because I thought that the subway had to go above ground, and I ended up in Coney Island. I got back, and it was about the fourth, and they were playing Kansas City. And I actually felt like I was walking into the Vatican. And the first, they were playing Kansas City.
You were,
as far as
baseball is concerned.
And I came through, I'll never forget, in right field, Roger Maris was playing right field for Kansas City. And that's the first Major League Baseball player I ever saw in person. But I just can't imagine what it would be like to go into that locker room and know that you're part of that team.
Yeah. Well, I remember, you know, I was called, when they gave me the call at Richmond, my manager was Cal Ermer, later managed in the big leagues. With Minnesota, and anyway, Cal called me in the office. We had a night game, and he said, don't bother to dress. The Yankees have called you up, you know. And, of course, it's a thrill. But he said, they want you up there tomorrow morning. And so Richmond in New York isn't that far, and I went home, packed my car and everything, and took off. And it was Saturday morning when I was supposed to arrive. And, you know, because you'd been to spring training with all those guys, you knew them. You know, it wasn't like you didn't know anybody. You knew the players. You didn't know them well, but they knew who you were and you knew who they were. But I wanted to get to the stadium first because I'd rather be there and as guys come in, be able to say hi to them and so on, than they all be there and me walk in and everybody yeah. comes over, you know. So I got there real early and...
You're there at 6 a.m.
I got there early. I drove straight there. And
Did you sleep much that night?
No, not at all, but... I didn't figure I was starting anyway with that lineup. So anyway, Pete Sheehy, who's immortal in our clubhouse now at Yankee Stadium, is named after him. He would have been around since Babe Ruth.
I've heard of him.
Just a fantastic individual. I walked in the clubhouse, and he was obviously the only one there at the time. And he took me over to my locker, and my locker's right next to Mantle's, right? My idol. And so, I mean, I'm looking up there, and it says Tresh. Mantle, and my heart's going bang, 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 you know. And hanging in my locker is my uniform number 15, my dad's number.
Wow.
And he knew that. He knew it was my father's number.
Did he do that on purpose?
Yes, and that number happened to be open. And
that's great.
And, of course, it wasn't many low numbers there anyway.
Oh, retired.
Yeah.
One so, twice.
Yeah.
Number eight's been retired twice.
Exactly.
Bill Dickey and Yogi Berra.
Yeah, two catchers.
That had to be a while.
So anyway, then I, you know, after I kind of got settled in and I did the old traditional thing. I walked down the runway into the dugout and up on it to home plate, and I stood up there. It was a nice sunshiny morning, and I looked out there and the monuments and everything, and I did just, you know, like you would think.
Like
I stood up
imagine.
To the plate and visualized DiMaggio and Ruth and Gehrig and all the great players that have stood there, not only Yankees but other teams. It was a tremendous feeling. Tremendous feeling.
Well, you know, you almost became a Yankee, didn't you? Bill Dickey was chasing you pretty good.
Yeah. Had I not signed with the Cardinals, I would have signed with the Yankees. And then when I signed with the Cardinals, 2 years later, they signed Jake Gibbs out of Ole Miss. Was an All-American football player. And you ended up knowing Jake.
Jake's a very good friend of mine, yeah.
Jake's a great guy and was a baseball coach down at Ole Miss for a lot of years, and I've known him for a long time.
I mean, was there any concern, age 17, to get into a man's world? I mean, you know, you weren't even eligible to vote.
Age 17, to do a lot of things.
But you were in the major leagues at age 17. Were your parents concerned a little bit about you going into a very mature adult world with a lot of pressure and you know, a lot of things that normal 17-year-olds aren't? No. How do you prepare yourself for that jump?
That's a good question. You're so young. Contrary to what Tom said about promising his parents that he'd go to college, I thought I wanted to go to college, but if I did that, I'd have to go one semester a year. So by signing out of high school, it was, you know, I signed for a bonus, and my bonus was more money than my father was ever make in his lifetime. My father was
Memphis
a policeman.
Policeman,
right. And I signed for a $75,000 bonus, and that was, you know, a ton of money for me and my family and in those days. And going, you know, I'd never played against an African-American ball player, ever.
Being in Memphis, probably.
And, Memphis was segregated at the time. So I was sent to Keokuk, Iowa, in the Midwest League. And at that time, the Cardinals had 24 farm teams. And Keokuk had such glamorous towns as Clinton, Iowa, and Michigan City, Indiana, Paris, Illinois, Waterloo, Iowa, Davenport, Iowa, things like that. And I had my first experience playing with black players, and it was quite a cultural shock for me, and I'm sure for some of the black players.
Well, $75,000 is a lot of money to a 17-year-old. I mean, let's go back that many years. I mean, that was a tremendous amount of money. Did your parents say anything to you when you were packing up and ready to leave? I mean, you probably hadn't spent much time away from home.
I'd been to St. Louis twice to see major league games, to see the Cardinals play. I saw Mantle in his in his rookie year in 1951 when the Yankees were in playing against the Browns, St. Louis Browns. Then the Browns moved to Baltimore in 1954. But I hadn't traveled much, no.
If you had a son, I know you've got two daughters, if you had a son and he had the same opportunity that you had, and say we make it 1,750,000 because of what's changed in the world, would you be hesitant to let him go into the major leagues at that age, at 17? What would be your reaction?
That's speculative. I don't know. I don't know what I would do. But if he wanted to do it, and I wanted to do it in those days, I mean, and the money made it easy for me to decide that it was the right thing to do, but I would leave it up to him if he was 17. I'd try to advise him on it, but you know, it's
not going to take long for him to be 18.
That's right.
That's probably what he'd tell you.
Yeah, but was there 16 teams back then? Was there 16, 8?
There were 16 teams in 59. Yeah. The first expansion was 1961 when the Angels came in, and then Houston came in the National League. So there were 18 teams. There were 20 teams, I guess.
The 16 two came when in, I signed in 58.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how many jobs 16, were there available in Major League Baseball?
Not a lot. And one out of every 200 that signed made it to the major leagues.
One out of every 200
for one day or just a period of time. So one out of 200, would the odds were against you regardless of your talent.
They had large farm systems. The Yankees, when I signed, they had 13 minor league teams.
We had 24 in St. Louis.
Did you?
So yeah, 24. Now they had four or five.
Yeah, exactly. And you have, I mean, you got a system of Yankee minor leaguers at 200-300 players.
Yeah, because I mean, there wasn't that many jobs and it wasn't that kind of money on the table. So if a rookie comes in and takes the job, he's taken away from somebody who's been there. I mean, there was no expansion. I mean, was there any? I remember there was a guy named Don Blasingame. He played second.
A Blazer from sure. Corinth, Mississippi.
And he and Pete Rose, when they brought him up, he replaced Don Blasingame. And the story I heard was that Blasingame was very well liked, and as a result, Rose took a lot of heat because he replaced Blasingame. Was that going on at that time because of the disparity of the jobs? I mean, there just wasn't that many jobs, and like you say, the odds of getting there.
The older players on the teams that I played, and I came up in 59, 60, and 61. Tom and I played in the minor leagues against one another. He played with Richmond. I played with Charleston in 1961. And I spent parts of 59, 60, and 61 up. And there was a different feeling, the guys. I mean, I really can't say that there was no help, but there was less help for younger players then than there was to be a couple of decades later when we were older players and younger players came up, because we learned from that. And
who did you replace?
I replaced Gene Oliver at the time. The Cardinal catcher, Hal Smith, had a heart attack in 1961, and so he was his career for the most part was over. And then when I started catching, my first full year was 63, and we had Gene Oliver and Carl Sawatsky, and then they traded Oliver in June, and I became the number one catcher.
You made the All-Star team. Like your second year, wasn't it, with the
first
Yankees?
First and second
as a shortstop. One year, wasn't it?
First year as a shortstop.
And here you are, the number. You're the starting shortstop for the American League All-Star team, and the following year you couldn't even make the team as a shortstop. Am I correct?
Well, what happened? You know, you have to go back
as a shortstop.
What happened in 1961 when I got called up to the Yankees last month of the season? Like we were talking, Tony Kubek is a shortstop. Bobby Richardson is second baseman. Over that next year, the Cuban crisis appears. I had been in for a six-month active duty and was in a reserve unit in New York. Tony Kubek had been in for 6 months active duty and was in a control group or National Guard unit in Wisconsin. And they happened to activate the Wisconsin National Guard, which meant that Tony had to go in the Army. So all of a sudden, the starting job in New York was open. And the utility shortstop
in 61 was Joe DeMaestri, and he retired over that season. So all of a sudden, you had, going to spring training, you had the starting shortstop gone and the utility shortstop gone. And so myself and Phil Lenz were the candidates for those two positions. And we kind of had a, you know, the press played it up, but a kind of a battle, you know, for the starting job. And I ended up with the starting, you know, the starting job, and Phil ended up with the utility job, and then, you know, that's how it went from there. And then Tony got back out of the Army in August, and they played him for a couple of weeks in the outfield, in left field. And then we were in Minneapolis about somewhere around a month to go in the season, and Ralph Houck called me into the office, and we sat down, and he said, you know, you obviously know Tony's back. He said, your bat has to be in the lineup, and Tony has to be in the lineup. And he said that, he said, what I'd like to see is I'd like to see you play left field with Mantle in center and Roger in right, so I don't have to platoon that position anymore. He said, if you're agreeable, it's your position. I'm not going to take you out. You're in there. You're not trying. I know you can play it.
He didn't want to leave Kubek in left and leave you at short?
It didn't make sense because Tony Kubek was a great shortstop, and he'd played with Bobby Richardson for like 3 years in the minors, as well as about three. He'd played, I think, 3 years in the majors at that time. And Tony was a rookie of the year in 1957. So, I mean, I'm just tickled to be there, you know. And so I said, you know, that's fine. And he said, okay, tonight, he said, we had a night game. He said, tonight, just go take the fly balls in the outfield, because we used to take infield back then, right?
Sure.
Go take fly balls in the outfield, make the throws to the bases. And he said, I'll give you the night off, and we'll start you tomorrow. We had a day game tomorrow. So I said, that's fine. So I went out, and I made the throws of the bases, and I caught the fly balls and everything, and came back in and was changing my sweatshirt. And Ralph came over and said, I was watching you out there. You're really good. He said, you start tonight. So, I mean, I hadn't played any place but shortstop, you know, since junior high school.
Shows you how good an athlete, though.
So
to be able to make that.
Absolutely. Well, you know.
Absolutely.
But, you know, shortstop is a real good position to do everything else from. Because you have to be play shortstop in the major leagues, you got to be able to go back on the ball good, you know. And I did that well, so I had no fear of going back.
What was it like in left field? And you're looking over and you're seeing Madeline Maris, the other your partners.
Well, I might add, left field in Yankee Stadium to this day is the most spacious left field in the major leagues.
Yes.
Yeah. Joe Torre thinks that you have to have two center fielders in the outfield, one in left, one in center.
Well, remember when we played left center.
Is that much space?
Left
center
field, when Tim and I played there in the World Series, left center field was 457 feet from home plate. Mm-hmm. Now Monument Park is out there, and they have a fence that fences off Monument Park. But when we played, that was all playing field.
That's right.
And you could actually,
worse then than it is now.
You could actually hit a ball. You'd hit a ball and it looked like it was going to be over your head, and you started running after it, and it would kind of reach its apex, and instead of going like that, it would actually start coming almost straight down.
Why?
Because you lose the power at a point in time,
yeah.
And so it doesn't run out as far as it ran up. It goes out, and then it just starts to come down, and you actually started catching up to that ball. And it was pretty hard to hit a ball over somebody's head in what we call Death Valley, because Mantle or I would catch it. And we squeezed the left center field anyway, because you couldn't put, there was no sense to play left field down the line because it was so short that if a person hit it good, it would
have a anyway. To this day at Yankee Stadium, everything caroms back to the left fielder anyway down the line. So you can afford to play off the line,
right,
and play toward left center field.
Somebody hits a ball, you got to go to break. I could go all night on this. If somebody hits a ball between you and Mantle, you're both going for the ball. I can still remember when his rookie year, remember when he and DiMaggio, when he caught himself on the sprinkler head. And
sprinkler head, right.
Irreparable damage.
Messed his knee up.
Yep, bad. Who would make the call? Would Mantle say it's mine, or would he?
You know, Mantle always makes the call. Center fielder makes the call over the left fielder, who's ever in center, whether... You know, when I was playing some center field and Mickey was in left, then I would call it, but that's...
When Mickey says, I got it, Mickey
has it.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
When Muzio used to say, I got it.
Whatever you say.
So Mr. Muzio caught the ball.
Okay, well, I'll tell you what. Mike, let's just do it all. We'll have all the commercials at one time. We'll be back in about 6 minutes. Okay, so hang in there. We got a lot more to talk about with two very, very, very entertaining guests. You're going to spoil me, Sam. We'll be right back.
Patrick's at 5 points is the place to go when you want to unwind. Patrick's, voted year after year as Sarasota's best bar and restaurant. This New York-style bistro offers casual dining, plus a full menu served daily 11 a.m. to midnight. Meet your friends in the grill room, where the staff knows your name. Watch the NFL ticket on 5 TVs and cheer on your favorite team. For sports, food, and drink, it's Patrick at 5 points, a Sarasota tradition since 1985.
Sarasota Kennel Club, where you don't have to wait to be a winner.
Where do sports fans go for burgers, authentic buffalo wings, a full liquor bar, and Chicago-style stuffed pizza? Of course, it's Krusty's Sports Bar and Grill. A Sarasota tradition for 15 years, located in the south wing of Paradise Plaza next to Publix. Krusty's offers a full menu featuring homemade recipes for eat-in, take-out, or delivery. And don't forget, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 5 till midnight, free pizza in the lounge. So for the ultimate in casual dining and sports bar experience, the place to go is Krusty's Sports Bar and Grill.
Pro Golf Discount is the answer for all your golfing needs. We offer a full line of branded golf equipment and apparel, more than anyone else in the area. All value priced with names such as Callaway, King, Taylor, Mizuno, FootJoy, and Cobra. We cater to men, women, juniors, and even that golfer-to-be in your family. And don't forget to check out our full swing simulator that produces computerized graphs to assist you in the right club selection. Visit our two convenient locations, 3836 South Tuttle Bee Ridge Road or 7690 South Tamiami Trail.
The Sports Page Bar and Grill, a Sarasota landmark for over 18 years, offers fine food, drinks, along with 12 TVs bringing you every imaginable sports event. The Page now has a full-service liquor store at its Main Street location. DK Wine and Spirits offers wine from around the world, imported beers, cordials, and liqueurs, and even includes cigars. So on your next visit to the Sports Page, go next door and visit the fine people at BK Wine and Spirits.
It's not just a few price reductions. It's a total sale at Sarasota Ford. Everyone gets new 03 Explorers from $19,499, 03 F-150s $11,999, Expeditions just $25,352 or $99 a month. It's a total sale on over 700 vehicles certified from $89.99. Quality checked by Ford. Certified gold checked by Sarasota Ford. The Gulf Coast Ford Giant on the beautiful corner of 41 and 301.
Sarasota Ford.
Sure is. Boy, it's a hidden secret locally, but Wings and Weenies has the finest breakfast in all of Sarasota County. It's unbelievable. Look at this steak and eggs. Delicious.
Aren't you the owner?
Yeah, I'm the owner. Shows we eat our own food.
I eat lunch here 5 times a week. Sometimes I have one of the many nice specials that they serve or one of the many sandwiches.
Aren't you the floor manager?
Well, yeah, but they pay me extra to eat in front of the customers.
Wings and Weenies, we're more than just Wings and Weenies.
Holy offense, number 57, 10-yard penalty, repeat third down. We know they probably hold on virtually every play of the game. However, we purposely waited until now to actually make the call at this very critical juncture of the game. Just to tick you off.
For only $50, golfers can save up to 45% off green fees and carts at 31 of our area's best golf courses. Enjoy giant savings and unlimited play, include prime tee times, advanced registration privileges, and a royal treatment with your 2003 Big Summer Golf Cart. Also, join our Big Money Tour, where it's not how you play, it's how often. Call 923-2232 or visit any of the participating courses for more information.
The Athlete's Foot is the place to go for your athletic footwear and apparel needs. Over 700 stores and 30 years experience. The Athlete's Foot offers a complete selection of current and retro models for athletes of all ages, Nike, Adidas, and Reebok. Take advantage of their exclusive foot analysis system, which ensures the perfect fit for the sport of your choice. So get fit at the Athlete's Foot.
Wow.
Welcome to Evie's Car Wash and Golfing Fun Center. Get Southwest Florida's number one car wash featuring soft cloth, state-of-the-art equipment. While your car is getting the full treatment, we'll provide you with a free bucket of golf balls. Tune up your game with golf lessons from the pros. Evie's features McLean's homemade ice cream and Mean Jean's fresh-made, fresh-baked pizza. That's Evie's Car Wash and Driving Range on Bee Ridge Road, Sarasota.
Smokey's Barbecue and Grill, featuring the best pork ribs in town with a full menu including pulled pork and smoked wings. Enjoy live blues music every Friday night, a full liquor bar, 10 TVs, and even an outdoor bar for smokers. So head straight to Smokey's Barbecue and Grill for lots of fun and good food. Your taste buds will thank you.
Okay, back again with Tom Tresh, Tim McCarver, and Scotty Hayes. Scotty, throw some questions at
these great guests. No, two legends. I want to ask both of you, Tim, as the broadcaster, and Tommy, as the ex-Yankee, the A-Rod deal. A lot of people talking about A-Rod, whether he would go to Boston, whether he'd end up a Yankee. Good for the game or not?
I think it's good for the game because the deal was made. I mean, it couldn't be made in Boston because the union wouldn't allow any player, A-Rod included, to downsize his salary and to get a salary that was for less money than he made with the Texas Rangers. That's not in the bargaining chips of that the players' union has with Major League Baseball. So the deal was nullified. Had that deal happened, the Red Sox are a powerhouse because they get rid of Manny Ramirez, and they've had problems with Manny Ramirez in the past. They add Alex Rodriguez. Nomar Garciaparra goes to the White Sox, and the Red Sox get Maglio Ordonez. So it would have been a power-laden lineup for the Red Sox and ball club had they gotten Alex Rodriguez. But the Yankees, as they are prone to do, they can smell out a good deal under Steinbrenner.
It wouldn't have happened if Aaron Boone hadn't gotten hurt, though, would it?
Oh, I think it would have.
You really think
yeah,
so?
I think I do. Yeah. Any chance you have anytime you have a chance to get a guy like Rodriguez for a good ball player. Now, Alfonso Soriano is a great player.
Sure.
But when you have a chance to get Rodriguez, you make the deal.
Tom, when you look at the Yankees, you know, you see this incredible payroll. And Donnie and I have talked about it many times on the show that throughout baseball history, there have been the rich and there have been the not so rich. As an ex-Yankee, do you see the Yankees playing with an unfair advantage when you can look at $180 million to throw out of players where a Tampa Bay is throwing out like 25?
No. You know, it's always been an uneven playing field.
Always.
You know, so I don't know that it's any different. I know that Gene Autry tried to buy a team for many, many years, and, you know, it's not just a matter of money. It's a lot of other things. Look at the Yankees' farm systems. You know, Pettit came out of that system. Jeter sure. came out of that system. Posada came out
Williams.
Of that system. Bernie Williams came out of that system. When you can have a good nucleus of superstar-type players come out of your organization, it's easier to kind of pull in one here and one there. But it's hard to buy a complete team.
It gets back to management. I mean, just like any corporation, if it's managed well, it's going to do well. And the Yankees have managed their their organization well.
And you know what? With that said, you know, I heard you earlier talking about, you know, Rogers' 61st home run off of Tracy Stalin, or what, 23,000 people at Yankee Stadium. And it was that last year was the first time the Yankees ever led the American League in attendance. And Tim, you're around that situation up there. Why have the Yankees had this improved influx of attendance, where for years people just watch the games on TV, they've avoided the Bronx, whatever?
Well, number one is New York's a National League town. And if the Mets, prior to the Mets being there, if the Dodgers and the Giants were doing well, they'd blow the Yankees out as far as attendance is concerned. If the Mets were doing well in the 1980s, sure, and the Yankees weren't, blew them out of the tank. The Yankees didn't draw 3 million people for the first time until 1999. The Mets did it 15 years earlier,
sure,
in 1986, so 14 years earlier. So, even with the lore that the Yankees have, if the Mets were doing as well as the Yankees were doing right now, the Mets would get twice the television ratings that the Yankees are getting. A lot of people don't know that.
That's really interesting about the National League, because if you go back to, you guys are talking about the expansion, when the Mets first came off, they were not competitive at all until, mm-hmm, Seaver's team in, what was it, 69. And yet the Mets were out losing 100 ball games, were outdrawing the Yankees, who were winning championships when Tom was playing there. And I think that whole thing, National Leaguers and all the National Leaguers, Giants fans and Dodger fans, all became Mets.
Well, in fairness, you know, when you had three New York teams, you had two in the National League. The Giants and the Dodgers, yeah, were both in the National League. So you have, you know, New York being as diverse as it would stand to reason that you'd have probably twice as many,
sure,
National League fans as American League fans.
Sure. I think baseball in general, needs a strong Yankee team. Love them or hate them.
Oh, no question about it. That's a very good point.
You know what I'm saying? When the Yanks go in this year with this lineup, they're going to sell out. The home teams are going to be grateful that the Yankees are coming to town. And without a strong Yankee team, you've lost a lot of the casual fans for at least the regular season.
Well, if baseball needs a strong Yankee team, they got them.
Yeah, here's a team, though, Tom, that doesn't, Tim doesn't have, not have a starting left-handed pitcher. There's a
after
couple
of losing Pettit, right?
And Contreras
needed
and
Cleveland in 48.
Any question marks?
That's right.
There's a lot of question marks, I would think, on the pitching as far as his
Cleveland
injury.
Cleveland in 54.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you talk about Cleveland in 54, they won 111 games. Of course, Cleveland in 54 didn't have a short porch like the Yankees have. That could be a problem for.
But
Bisc,
a short
hitter.
Porch is overrated, because you lose a lot of home runs by trying to pull the ball. You hit a lot of home runs foul.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot easier to hit toward a reasonable alley in left center or right center, because then you can hit the ball straight away.
That said, left-handed pull hitters should pay their way in the Yankee Stadium to hit.
It's true.
And you know that.
When I was a switch hitter, I could only do a part of the
Yogi,
time.
It was 296 down the right field line. When Yogi hit, when Babe Ruth hit, it's a bandbox.
Yeah, but it went straight out to 344.
Straight out to 344, right.
Yeah. And then left field was what, 4-something?
Well, Boston. Forever, 457.
Look at Boston center. Down the line. It's only like 300 feet down the
That's
line.
Right. Well, I'm only kidding, but, I mean, the Red Sox say that. The great hitters that the Red Sox have had over the years with the Green Monster out there have been left-handed hitters.
If you look at Yaz and Ted Williams, the only right-hander that really
put
a lot of home runs is Jim Rice.
Pete Reynolds, Carl Yastrzemski, Wade Boggs, Ted Williams.
Sure.
Do you think, Tommy, do you think they're doing the right thing by putting Rodriguez at third?
Well, I think that's the only thing you could do. I think Derek is the captain of the ball club, and he's done everything at shortstop that you'd ever want him to do, and he's a leader. And
who's a better shortstop?
Well, I've not been able to see the players play well enough times. I'm sure that Tim has, but I haven't, to be able to judge that, you know.
Rodriguez is, but you can't make that move. Tom's exactly right. I mean, Jeter's the leader in that leader on that ball club, and he's the shortstop. And let's face it, I mean, you know, he may not be the best shortstop in the American League, but he's one of the best money players in baseball. So you don't want to tinker with Jeter, and Rodriguez is an extraordinary athlete. Anybody who goes to the University of Miami is a great athlete, right?
That's you're really doing good.
But no, he is, and making that move is an easy thing to do.
Could it hurt his changing a position? Okay, and granted, it's not a dramatic, but the third, I think, is a lot. You're a lot closer. I think you have to be a great athlete to play third. Do you think it could possibly, two things, could it possibly affect his hitting? Jim Fregosi said when he went from whatever position to third, he was concentrating so much on being a good third baseman that it took away the concentration from hitting. And also, it's not known as a good park for right-handed hitters. I mean,
yeah, but A-Rod's got great power to right center and right field. That's his power stroke the other way.
So that will affect.
That's not going to affect.
Well,
him at all.
I think number one, I had the chance to move from. I was a shortstop, and then they moved me to the outfield, and then we had some trouble back in the infield again. So they moved Boyer to short, moved me over to third, and it's a lot different.
It is.
It's a lot different. Why is it? I'd rather play second base as a shortstop than third base. Third base, you're in close, and it's a reflexes position more than anything. You got to be able to go one or two steps really quick, dive, you know, and that kind of stuff. Where at short and second, you can catch up to balls up the middle. If you got speed, you can go get it, you know, and make your play. And
Ralph, I just think Ralph Kiner once said that third base was a reactionary position,
yeah,
which meant that you had to be a reactionary to play it.
But you're right, you had to play the hop that you would get. You didn't have time. At short, the ball's hit at you, and most of the time you can either move after the ball a little quicker or a little slower to get the hop that you want. At third base, you don't have that chance. All of a sudden, boom, the ball's hit, and if it's an in-between hop, that's what you got. You don't have a chance to play the ball.
So this is an adjustment, though. You're telling me that this move for him is an adjustment, like you went through it. Did it affect your hitting at all when you were playing third? Did you have?
Nah, I mean, I don't remember that it did, but I only played half a season there. Mm-hmm. They moved me back to the outfield. Finally found one I couldn't play as well, I guess.
But you know, you don't see that many really power hitters at third. I know Troy Glaus, with the Angels is, but not, and Ken Boyer, you know, of course, with you, Tim, with the Cardinals, was a
Greg Nettles.
Nettles led the league.
Nettles was a real power hitter, mm-hmm. Great third baseman.
Yeah, we're running out of time. Who do you like this year, Timmy?
I like the Cubs a lot. I think the Cubs stole Derek Lee from Florida. I think Florida's going to be a good team. I think the Phillies are going to be a good team. I think Houston's going to be a good team. I think the National League West has been weakened. I love the Yankees and Red Sox, and I wouldn't be a bit surprised to see a Yankee-Red Sox 7-game playoff again this year.
What about you, Tommy?
Well, I haven't followed the National League as close, but I think the Cubs are there and as the first pick. In the American League, it's Boston and New York, and that's how you're going to call it. They're both really strong, and Boston has a pitching edge, and probably the Yankees have the hitting edge. But
that said, Anaheim's with Vladimir Guerrero is a very, very. They have Bartolo Colon, Vladimir Guerrero. Baltimore's an improved team. Toronto's an improved team because they have a lot of young talent that has improved. Kansas City could give some people problems. I think Kansas City will win the American League Central. It's so much fun, though, at this time of year because everybody's a winner.
What about what did you do here? What did you write there?
You know what? Thanks.
What is that?
Talk a little bit about this.
I'm glad.
I
wrote this book, and that was after Game 5 with Bob Gibson.
That was the one we were talking about?
Give a shout out to that, guys. That was Bob Gibson who won that game, and I had the... Oh gosh, the home run in that game, and it was. Anyway, this is a book about the 1,900 or so Cardinal players that have played for the St. Louis Cardinals, and it's who was the best at their position, and there was a lot of controversy when we wrote that. I wrote it with Phil Pepe, who's a writer with the New York Daily News, and it's about it's for Cardinal fans as much as anybody, but. It's a book that that was very controversial as far as who was the best player at that position because...
Who was the best catcher for the Cardinals?
Ted Simmons.
I don't think so.
Ted Simmons. Ted Simmons hit more line drives, he hit more balls hard in 1973 than any player I've ever heard about, seen on a regular basis. He must have hit 400 balls right on the button. And with any luck, he could add 280 hits.
This is available in Sarasota?
It certainly is. I hope it is.
Where? Books-A-Million?
Books-A-Million, Barnes & Noble. Okay. And if it's not, we can make it available.
Okay. Party question.
Yeah, oh,
party
right.
question.
Like
party right.
Pitcher.
Who was the number one pitcher of all time you had for the Cardinals?
For the Cardinals, Bob Gibson.
Good choice.
Hmm. Okay, well, I think we got
pretty easy choice, too.
Yeah.
Okay, we got to wrap it up. I still remember that game in June of 63 when Gibson and Sandy Koufax out in California. The greatest baseball game I ever saw in my life.
I had, I know you guys are tight on time, but this week I had a, Jim Cott had a dinner party for Sandy Koufax, Bob Gibson, Bill White, and he included me. So the five of us sat and talked baseball several days ago in Stuart, Florida, and it was as memorable an evening as I've ever had.
I would love to have been a fly on that wall.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks so very, very much. You just made this show for us. I appreciate it. Hope we can get you back sometime. You're both living down here now, so there's no excuse, but thanks. I know it. Appreciate it. See you all next week. Sorry we couldn't get to the phones, but I think you understand. That'll do it.